Today's lecture, it is lecture number 11, and here we will discuss about various tests for convergency of a series. Okay, so we will see that intermediate term sequence of partial sum that will go away. Okay, we don't have to focus on that only. Directly we will give attention to the series which is given there. Okay, so just based on series we try to establish various convergency result. And we will see that those would be very interesting and simple. It is not complicated kind of thing. And if you understand the test of convergence of series, then what will happen? This will also, it would be followed by integration as well. That improper integration will come. That time always we talk about the existence of integral or existence of integration of a function. So those things will also carry forward there in integration as well. So everyone just focus on here series so that it will help to understand integration in a much better way. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would talk about test of convergency or divergency. Whenever I am saying that convergency, then convergency include both things, divergency or convergence both. So that is the meaning of convergence. That means when someone is saying that what is meaning of when we are discussing about convergence of a series, simply what does it mean? If series is convergent, then simply we will say that series is convergent. If series is divergent, then simply we will say that series is diverging. So that's why convergence include both things. So it may lead towards a divergent series, it may lead towards convergent series. Okay, so both things would come. So that is the meaning of test of convergence. And one simplest result I will talk about here in the first part of this lecture. After that we will discuss in detail about various other tests of convergence. Okay, various other tests of convergence will come here. We will see those things in detail. So coming to test of convergence, that convergence or divergence of a series, we are used to always using positive words. So that's why I'm saying that test of convergence. Otherwise, few people may call it test of divergence as well. So that means you are verifying that whether series is divergent or not. If series is not divergent, what does it mean? It would be otherwise. That means series would be convergence. So you can go for affirmative or non-affirmative. Depends upon what approach you are having. So one simplest test, it is talking about nth test of nth term test. So it is really interesting in sense that it is not good for established convergence of a series, that convergent of series, but it is very good for divergence of series. That means if you are just checking for nth term, and suppose that nth term is not converging to zero, then you can claim that the corresponding series would be divergent. Otherwise, if nth term is converging to zero, you can't say anything about convergence of series. Convergence of series, you can't say anything. But nth term is going to, it's like if you take nth term, suppose you are having a series like this way, whose nth term is an, and you just focus on nth term here right now. That means you are just giving attention to a single term. If this term is not converging to zero, it is not converging to zero, then what does it mean? Simply we can say that series is this, we see that series is divergent. If it is not converging, nth term is not converging to zero, then we will say that series is divergent. Then there is a very simple notation of divergent series is what? How we denote divergent series? Anyone would like to highlight how we denote divergent series? That means sum would be infinity. It would be equal to infinity. That is the representation of one Lehmann representation of a divergent series. That means if nth term is not approaching to zero, then simply we can claim that the sum would be infinity. That means series is divergent. Infinity, simply I have already told many times, infinity is not a number. And what is significant of this word? This one is symbolic representation. Simply it says that series is divergent. Divergence. Series is divergent. That is the meaning. Okay. So everyone might be agree with this one. Okay. Now, but what will happen? Very fine. what will happen if suppose you come up with nth term and that one is converging to zero, then can you talk about convergence of series? Then that time you can't say anything about whether series is going to converge or not. Series may converge, may diverge here. So it is inconclusive in nature. So you can't say anything here. There would be a question mark. Simply there would be a question mark, like we can't say anything. What would be this? There is a question mark. Focus on this question mark. So we need further advanced test in order to verify convergence of a series. Like we will see various examples there. So simply it is not that nth term is going, nth term test is not for actually establishing convergence of a series. It is just for establishing divergence of a series. When nth term is not going to converge to zero, then we simply can say that divergent series is divergent, the corresponding series is divergent. That is the criteria. So how we see it like this way? Okay, it is coming like, okay, suppose we are having a series, this is the series, given series, and S is the corresponding sequence of partial sum. Then we say that this series is converging. What does it mean? The corresponding sequence of partial sum is also converging. And where does it converge? It converges to S. In that case, we write limit of the sequence of partial sum is equal to S, because this sequence is converging to S. That's why we are saying that. And hence, what will happen? We can define nth term as a difference of two successive partial sum. How? We know from the definition how we define Sn. Sn, it is talking about sum of first n term of the sequence. So that is the meaning of Sn. So it has been generated from the given sequence. That means Sn is coming like this way, x1 plus x2 plus, likewise it will go up to xn. Okay, xn minus 1, and next term would be xn. Okay, but what you call this first n minus 1 term? What is name of this first n minus 1 term? Anyone? Sn minus 1. Okay. Sn minus 1. Very nice. So that's way, what would be xn? From this definition of Sn, xn would be what? Difference of Sn and Sn minus 1. If you bring it in the side of Sn, then this is the definition of xn. Also can be defined as a difference of Sn and the two consecutive term of the sequence of partial sum. Okay, and if you take limit both sides, then what will happen? That if you are taking limit both sides, then we see that here in Sn is having one more extra term than Sn minus 1. And we know that if in a sequence, if you just truncate few of the term, then convergence is not going to affect and limit is also not going to change. So that's way, if you are trying to find limit of this Xn, the limit of Xn would be difference of limit of Sn and Sn minus 1. And we know that this Sn is converging to S. That's way, this will also converge to S, limit would be S, and this would also converge to S. So limit of Sn would be what? S minus S means 0. So simply we can say that here the nth term in the convergent series is converging to 0. So that means convergent of a series implies, simply in short, if you are willing to write this one in short, then in short you can write it like this way. If you are taking a series xn, okay, which is converging, how we denote convergent, convergent series? We denote it by saying that sum of the term of the sequence, it would be less than infinity. This value of the series would be less than equal to infinity. That is the representation, short representation of a convergent series, simply meaning of that. If a series is convergent, then simply it implies that action is approaching to zero, that nth term will approach to zero. The long statement, this mathematical statement what I have written here, same thing you can write in a simple mathematical term in just this implication. And everyone might be aware of that. If you are having a mathematical statement like this way that P implies Q, then it is logically equivalent to say that take contrapposity of this one, not Q implies not P. What does it mean? Anyone? What is meaning of not Q and not P? Can you apply this contrapositive here? Negation, yeah. Negation of the statement. Remember that any theorem or any definition, whatever in mathematics is coming, that happens to be a statement. That statement is having only two meaning. Either that statement would be true or false. There is no ambiguity. There would be no ambiguity. Only two, either it will be true or false. That is the meaning of a statement. Okay. So here we are having this, you can call it P. This convergent of series, you can call it this one P. Okay. That means series is convergent. And the conclusion part, this Q, always we call it conclusion part, call it Q. That nth term is going to converge to zero. Okay, so logically we can find a logical equivalence of this one. What would be that that term we what I introduced it here, contrapositive. We are calling it contrapositive. So how we say that here, we will say that this one is logically equivalent to negation of Q implies negation of P. Okay. Tell me what would be negation of Q? Negation Q is saying that action is converging to zero. What would be negation of action is converting to zero? Anyone? Yeah. Not. Just you have to smartly introduce the word not. So action is converging to zero. Then negation would be action is not converging to zero. Simply not, you have to use that not, negation word. So that's why simply say that action is not converging to zero. So in mathematically, how mathematics, how we denote it? We denote it like this way. Action is not converging to zero. That means whatever symbol is there, put a slant line. That will say action is not converging to zero. And what does it imply? What is the negation of this? Sequence is converging to series is converging to zero. So what is negation of this one? Anyone? It is not equal to not equal to less than infinity. That means equal to infinity. Simply you can say that. So that is the no. So we say that n varies from 1 to infinity. You can take it. Xn, simply we write like this way, Xn is not less than infinity. What is meaning of Xn is not less than infinity? What does it mean? Logically we can say that this one is equal to infinity. That means divergent. Don't take infinity as a number. I always used to say that, never say that infinity as a number. It is saying that it is a symbol. So we say that this one is divergent. That means the series is divergent. So that's why the nth test is meant for only divergency of series, not for convergency of series. Because if sometimes you will say that there are few series in which nth term is going to zero, but series may be divergent. We will see that. Like one example here, we are taking it, but if you try to establish whether a series is divergent or not, you just go for nth term. Like if you take a geometric series, this one is the geometric series, common ratio is R, and suppose we are taking common ratio such that absolute value of this common ratio is greater than 1. In that case, what we will observe here? We will observe here that if I say that if you are taking r to the power n and r is, modulus of r is greater than 1, the where does it converge? And when n is approaching to infinity, where does it converge? It is not going to converge to 0. It will diverge to infinity. If modulus of r is positive, if you are taking r is positive, it will diverge to infinity. If r is less than minus 1, it will have oscillatory nature. That in that r to the power minus 1, sometime it will, in that case, it would have oscillatory nature. When r is greater than 1, simply focus on r is greater than 1, then definitely it will go to infinity. So that means simply it is this r to the power n is not converging to 0. Simply you can claim that r to the power n is not converging to 0. That means nth term is not converging to 0. So due to that, you can directly claim that this series is divergent series. That means sum of this one is infinity. It is a divergent series. So through nth test, easily you can establish that divergence of a series. So it is very good for divergent series, not good for convergent series. Okay, now another convergence criteria for a series is coming with respect to Cauchy criteria. What does it say? It says that Cauchy was the famous mathematician who come up with a lot of result in series concept. So that's where several, many where you will see Cauchy result. So if you are having a series, this one, xn, summation from 1 to infinity, it will be convergent if and only if for every epsilon there exists a natural number k such that sequence of partial sum would eventually near to each other. Eventually near to each other. That means eventually what Cauchy criteria for sequence I had defined, same Cauchy criteria for sequence of partial sum I am defining in order to establish a convergence of a series. Again, you can say that here convergence of a series is directly implied from convergence of sequence of partial sum. So it is not, it is more theoretical, it is not having more computational approach, but this test is having computational approach. This one is the first one, so don't worry about this test too much. It is just a test for theoretical purpose. I won't go much in detail regarding that. So there is one more result. This one is the second result. This one is the third result. It is just based on monotone convergence theorem that we had already discussed about. As I told that most of the result of the sequence will be utilized for series as well. So that's why I'm just taking all these. So if you are having a sequence of positive real numbers, then what will happen? The corresponding series that generated by the sequence, it will be convergent if and only if the sequence of partial sum is bounded. So just we have seen that whether sequence of partial sum is bounded or not, when this series is generated by sequence of positive real numbers. So in that case, what would happen? So here by default, sequence of partial sum would be monotonically increasing because each term contains, each term of the sequence happens to be positive number, and sequence of partial sum contains Sn that happens to be sum of first n terms. So that's just you are adding positive number. If you keep on adding positive number, then it would be in always in a what, monotonically increasing fashion. So monotonically increasing nature is coming by default due to the definition of Sn, and just we will talk about boundedness. So in monotone convergence theorem, we always check for monotonicity and boundedness. So that's why here in the case of series where terms are happens to be positive real number, then just we have to see whether that corresponding sequence of partial sum is bounded or not. Otherwise things are simple. So in this case, what would be the suppose sequence of partial sum is bounded, and in that case, the sum of the series, it would be equal to that supremum of the range of the sequence of partial sum. Just in the similar fashion, what we had already gone through Monotone convergence theorem. So that's why I just come up with this one. Don't worry about those results. I will provide simple result. Okay. So here I'm just taking two a special kind of series, and we will get a lot of interesting application of this series later. So directly we will try to establish convergence of this series based on sequence of partial sum, and then we will get talk about the convergence of other series based on this simple series. So how we can establish that? So we are taking a two series. What does it mean? Two series means simply we are taking series where in denominator we observe power of n is 2. So that's why this, because of these two, we call this series two series. This is the two series generally we are calling it, that summation of 1 by n square, n varies from 1 to infinity. Here we can't vary n from 0 to infinity. We are varying n from 1 to infinity. So this one is a convergent series. How we can check for convergency? Again, that convergency we will decide it through sequence of partial sum. So let us go to define sequence of partial sum first. So we have to do little bit here manipulation. What we do? So we are taking a subsequence of the natural number. You can easily observe that if you are having a sequence like this way, then what you do? Just select few terms of the select terms by leaving few terms, by leaving even you can leave infinitely many terms. So this one is the given sequence, and if you change your indices like this in that way, nk change indices. So this is a subsequence of an. How it is coming like subsequence? We know that here n belongs to natural number. Here for this sequence domain is n, and but for this sequence what is the domain? Anyone may point out what is nk? What does it say? It say that we are taking domain. It is a subset of natural number. Even a subset of natural number may be also infinite. So here it is a subset of natural number. Here in this case nk is not taking this one subsequence. I have taken like this way. So like if you are collecting set of natural number as a sequence an equal to n, in that case, so one subsequence would come 2 to the power k minus 1, 2 to the power k minus 1. So here what kind of number will come in this sequence 2 to the power k minus 1? Can you highlight all those terms of this sequence? Yeah, just now point out directly. I'm pointing out. So what would be sequence of this one? Next would be next 7. Okay. So generally, you can say that this one is an infinite sequence, but it is containing natural number. It is containing natural number. What is natural number? It is just, if you try to see a sequence from natural number, it will contain all the natural number 1, 2, 3, 4, like that way. That it will go on like. So you can simply say that nk, if you are taking the sequence an equal to n, then an equal to n, then ank equal to nk, it is a subsequence of an. So that you can say that. So give for a given sequence, you can define various subsequence. So we come up with one subsequence of natural number, that nk, that is defined by 2 to the power k minus 1. With respect to this subsequence, we will just find what we call sum of partial sum. So sum of partial sum we will define. So we are defining SNK. So SNK, what does it mean? So we will see that we have to establish with respect to this subsequence, we have to establish that the corresponding sum of partial sum, partial sum, it would be less than 2. That means sum of term up to nk would be less than 2. We have to establish that. So how we can prove this one? Anyone may give idea? Have you seen such kind of proof? How we can prove generally if there is a natural number? In high school or plus 2, you might have already seen few result from algebra section, I think, where there is a involvement of natural number. So how we prove that if there is a natural number? Generally, if there is a natural number, then we prove it by mathematical induction. Have you heard the word mathematical induction? So how we prove that? We first check for a step one in which that given a statement would be true for few first value, okay, for few initial value that a statement would be true. Just we need to verify that first for few term it would be true, and then we take a induction statement. That means we suppose that for n it is true, and from there we try to establish that it is true for n plus 1. That if that a statement is true for n, then we try to establish that it is true for n plus 1. That means if suppose a statement is coming for n, we write it, it happens to be p a statement, s is just book for series and sequence of partial sums. So I won't write s again here, I will write p. So if you are having a mathematical statement, call it p. And if this statement is by default we have to see whether it is true for 1 or whether it is true even 1 is the statement is not valid for 1, then we try to check for initial value of n. So that initial value of n generally we denote it by n naught. So suppose it is true for n naught, so this one is the step 1. In the step 2, what we have to do, we have to assume that it is true for any general n. And if it is true for general n, and try to see that whether it implies that that statement is true for the next term where n plus 1 or not, whether the statement is true for n plus 1 or not, whether this one is implying the truth of this one or not. So that we are checking. This generally we are calling it induction statement. So only two, and later we finally we conclude that Pn is true for every n. Later we say that Pn is true for every n. So that is the perspective of mathematical statement. You might have already seen that. So in the similar fashion, we will see the result. So we will just check this inequality for few. We try to see the value of Sn for few initial nk, and later we will go further. Okay. So just we try to see it here. Yes. Limit of what? Actually, we are not finding limit of a series here. We are finding limit of a sequence of partial sum. That limit of sequence of partial sum would be, limit is associated with sequence or function. It is not associated with series. We are saying that if limit of there is a limit of sequence of partial sum, then we say that that limit would be the value of the series. Series is talking about, so it is sum of the terms of sequence, that given sequence xn. So sum of terms is this one. The sequence would be whose general term is 1 by n square. Okay. So the series is what? It is containing various terms, infinite number of terms. So series is sum of terms, simply you can say that. Sum of term. And this one is the sequence, Sn is the sequence. Snk is one subsequence, we can say subsequence of Sn, we can say that. We have taken a yes between 1 and 2. Just now I haven't said that it is between 1 and 2. I just saying that this value is less than 2. How we will see that how it is less than 2, that we have to see it. So I haven't established this one is a statement that we have to prove it. How we can prove it? So this one is the statement. You can call it P n k, this one is p n k. We have to prove that p n k is less than 2. So that is the mathematical statement that we have to establish. So how we can establish? So that I am saying that. So we can establish that it through mathematical induction. So we look for few value first. N1, take N1. That means k equal to 1. If you are taking k equal to 1, what will happen? What would be N1? Okay. So there. So I got answer from your side. So I am not verifying right now. Okay. So okay, very fine. So what will come there? Okay, nice. So that's where definitely you might see those things later again. Since 5 will not come. I have already taken those things. Okay. So here, if you are taking k equal to 1, then you are getting what? 2 to the power 1 minus 1. So it is just n1 is equal to 1. With respect to that, what would be the sequence of partial sum? That here, just n1 equal to 1, that just x1 will come. What is the value of x1 here? 1 by 1 square. So that's way Sn1 equal to 1. Now take k equal to 2, then you are getting n2. Then n2 is what does it mean? It is 2 to the power 2 minus 1. Simply it is 3. Okay, so that means you are trying to find Sn2 is what? Just S3. S3. That means S3 is what? It is sum of first three term of the sequence. X1 plus X2 plus X3. So what is X1? What is the first term? It is 1 by 1. That means 1. Second term is 1 by 2 square. Third term is 1 by 3 square. So everyone is agreeing with this. Is it fine? Just we are verifying the step 1 of the mathematical induction. Now after that, what we do? After that, what we do? We know that 1 by 3 is less than 1 by 2. So that's why 1 by 3 square would be less than 1 by 2. So here, with respect to this, focus on 1 by 3 square would be less than 1 by 2 square. So that's why we are putting this condition here. So easily we can say that now S3 is less than 1 plus 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 2 square. So 1 by 2 square, 1 by 2 square, it is coming 2 times. So it becomes 2 by 2 square. So that's why if you simplify it, it would be 1 plus 1 by 2. And if you further say that this value is less than 2. So easily we can say that S3 is less than 2. We have already seen that S1 is less than 2. It is equal to 1. S3 is also less than 2 with respect to N2. Okay, less than 2. Now, we look for N3. That means 2 to the power 3 minus 1. If you simplify, it is 7. That means Sn3 is what? S7. So here, we have to see a pattern. What is the pattern we have to see? So if you are writing Sn3, so Sn3 is what? If you try to see Sn3, we write it, it is talking of sum of first 7 term of the sequence. So, first of sum of first 7 terms of the sequence, x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus here, fourth term would be 1 by 4 square, fifth term would be 1 by 5 square, sixth term would be 1 by 6 square, seventh term would be 1 by 7 square. So, call this first 3 term, we generally denote it by S3. S3 is what? It is Sn2. So that's why Sn2 we have written. Okay. And why we are taking it? It is having a pattern that this one is less than 1 plus twice of 2 square. Two by 2 square. So that's why we have written like. And if you focus on this term, what is happening that each term here, each term is less than 1 by 4 square. So how many terms if you apply that inequality, so with respect to that you will observe that this Sn3 is less than 1 plus 2. It is just directly coming from S3, and this quantity would be what? This one is 1 by 4 square, but this quantity is less than 1 by 4 square, this quantity is less than 1 by 4 square, this quantity less than 1 by 4 square. So simply we can say that these quantity are less than 4 by 4 square. 4 by 4 square. So you remember that due to this kind of infinity, what we are taking it? It is coming in the power of 2. So if you simplify, finally you can claim that S7 is less than 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 square. So here always we observe here that series in term of with common ratio 2. Series in common ratio 2. Here also we had already observed that common ratio 2. Likewise, you can proceed for if you take a here just focus generalize this one. So here we have taken 3, k equal to 3. So here you can talk about like this way, up to what point you are getting. So you can say that this point is talking about 1 by 2 to the power 1. This one, if you forget about this 2, then you can write it like this way. It is talking about 1 by 2 to the power 2. And k is what here? In this third term, k is equal to 3. So we observe that Sn 3 is less than 1 plus 1 by 2 to the power 1 plus 1 by 2 to the power 2. So what does it say? This power is what? K 2 means 3 minus 1, that means k minus 1. So we can generalize this result to Snk, and we will say that actually Snk is less than 1 plus 1 by 2 to the power 1 plus 1 by 2 to the power 2 plus likewise 1 by 2 to the power k minus 2. Did you get it? Anyone? That is the approach to establish through mathematical induction. So that's we establish it through mathematical induction. And tell me, if you take k up to infinity, what would be sum of this series? This one is simply a geometric series. Everyone are aware of this one is a geometric series. If it will go on up to infinity with common ratio 1. And what is the sum of geometric series, infinite geometric series with common ratio 1 by 2? It would be just 2. So that's why I told that this Snk would be less than 2. Everyone might be aware of that. Okay. So we have already seen that if we are having a sequence, we come up with a subsequence of that sequence, we denote it by Snk. Snk, which is bounded above. Bounded above. It is bounded. A bounded below by 0. That means here 1 by n square, if you are talking about, every term is positive. Every term is positive. So that's where this one is a sequence of positive real number. And so by default, corresponding partial sequence of partial sum would be monotonically increasing. And next, it is bounded as well bounded. So due to this bounded nature, from monotone convergence theorem of sequence, we can claim that this sequence of partial sum is convergent. It is convergent. Okay, we come up with a very suitable kind. Even if you take someone is willing to take another kind of subsequence, there is no issue. You can go with another kind of subsequence. So if you come up with any kind of subsequence, definitely you will see it here that with respect to that subsequence, the corresponding sequence of partial sum would be bounded. Okay, but some negative may possible there. It is not that one is later part of this course. I will discuss later. So right now, we come up with that sequence of partial sum is bounded, and hence we can say that sequence of partial sum is convergent. And hence we can say that the corresponding series is convergent. So this series is a convergent series. Right now I am just trying to establish convergency of the series. Later I will talk about what is the value of that series? That means, what is the limit of the sequence of partial sum? That computational framework I will talk later. So there are various special technique you need to understand. Like sometimes you need to understand Taylor's theorem, sometimes you need to understand Maclaurin series, and there are various terms to find these sum of the series. There are various complicated things. So you need to know trigonometrical concept as well in order to find the value of the sum of the series if it is convergent. So that one is a little bit complicated, but later we will discuss that. Okay, now next we are claiming that we are taking a P series. That means here in 1 by in and we are taking 1 by n to the power p. That means power of p is here not 2, it is p. Okay, and generally we don't call power. Power is not a good word. Generally we can call it exponent. So what is the exponent of n here? P. So here if p is greater than 1, then we can say that this series is convergent. This one is convergent. If p is greater than 1, then it is convergent. If p is equal to 1, it is a divergent. If p is less than 1, then it is also divergent, a divergent series. So this series, this p series is divergent for p less than equal to 1, but it is convergent for p greater than 1. Okay, p greater than 1. That means again we will come up with the sequence of partial sum, and we try to establish whether that sequence of partial sum is bounded or not with respect to few or with respect to all subsequences. We have to come up with subsequences. So if you come up with same subsequences like nk defined by 2 to the power k minus 1, then you can easily establish that this partial sum, it would be bounded above by 1 by 1 minus r, are definitely bounded below by 0, because all these terms are positive. So by default it would be bounded below by 0. So we can easily establish in the same framework, we can establish that it would be bounded above by 1 by 1 minus r, where what would be r? R would be defined by this quantity. If r equal p, if p equal to 2, it is 2 series, r is equal to 1 by 2. If p equal to 1.5, then r would be different. So you can take any value of p greater than, remember that greater than p, then you will able to prove this result. And hence you can say that the corresponding series would be convergent if p is greater than 1. And how we establish that? Just we have to find the bound of sequence of partial sum. Just prove that that sequence of partial sum is bounded, just then your job is done. So it is, the proof is very simple. You can try yourself this one, you can try yourself in the similar framework what we had done for two series. Just try for this one p series, and you will be able to establish that that Sn would be bounded. Okay, I think it would be clear to everyone. It is already 10:30, so other things we will cover in next class. And regarding attendance, just to put your